So hello everyone, welcome to the seventh day of Limit Camp. You already had a lecture today by Professor Sushil Sarkar. So this is the third session on geometric group theory by Harshul Khanna. As you all know, Harshul Khanna is a third year BMAT student in ISI Bangalore. So you already had 2 days where he developed the foundations and basics of geometric group theory along with some revision, and today he'll do some more results on the same. So over to you, Harshul.
Right, thank you. So hello everyone. Let's start with the lecture. I'll share my screen. So I have a little, so I have something more to cover now, but I have a little less time. So I'll skip the recap, but I'll just let you know what we did last time. I'll not go over the proof or error or anything. So the last time we saw that, the Cayley graphs, for example, are a geometric object that can be thought of. So wait, let me minimize this. So Cayley graphs are a geometric object which can be related to a group and which have that group as a group of symmetries. Exactly that. Then we saw that the second class of geometric objects we considered were metric spaces, and we considered two metrics which were important to us: the path metric on a graph, which is the shortest distance with shortest path joining the two vertices, that is the length of the shortest path, and then we saw the group as a metric space where the distance between G and H is exactly the word length of G inverse H, and the word metric in a group corresponds with the path metric on its Cayley graph. Now using this metric, we can make concrete the facts that we stated, the observations that we did, that the Cayley graph of Z with respect to the generator 1 looks like a real line. So because the path metric, so the word metric on Z with generator 1 is the same Euclidean metric that Z inherits as the subset of R, and similarly for Z2, and this was the key observation that a group with a generating set is a metric space. Right, then we saw the isometries of a metric space, which are the bijections from that space to itself such that the distance is preserved. Like for example, we have the automorphism in graphs. These are the bijective functions in graphs such that the adjacency of the vertices is preserved. Here, distance is preserved, whatever your structure of your spaces. And then we saw that group action on metric spaces is just your normal action plus you have a distance preserving action, distance preserving axiom, which makes it action by isometries. So it's a homomorphism G to isometries of X. So for each G belonging to G, you get an isometry of X, which we denote by phi G, like this, right? Then we saw these were some examples, right? Then we transitioned from geometry to algebra. We related a geometric object, but how do we use it? So that we use by applying geometry to a geometric object and seeing how it translates to our algebraic object. So G is a torsion element if it has a finite order, and G is torsion free if the only torsion element is the identity element. And we proved this theorem that if G is a group that has a free action by isometries on your Euclidean space Rn, then G is also G is torsion free. So we transitioned from a geometric fact to a purely algebraic fact. So the proof of it involved a construction called centroid, which remained constant under a which was unique under a finite set, and we saw that applying G to it, which has a finite order, did not change the orbit of a point. Hence the finite set remains the same. And so centroid remains the same, but W must go to, so if W was a centroid, it must have gone to G dot W. That means G dot W is equal to W, but that means G is equal to the identity element. So the only element of the finite order is the identity element. Why this fails in your infinite case, suppose G was your infinite order element, right? Then here, when you apply G to your orbit, then you get G dot V, G square dot V, but you never get your V again. So the set changes. So centroid would also change. So you can't mimic this proof. That's why this thing does not work in infinite case. So we don't have any contradiction here. So if G is a finite ordered element, then it must be identity. Then we discuss this. The question to ask in geometric group theory: which groups act by isometries on which spaces? And if a group does act on the space, what does it say about the group? So that's a line of questioning we follow today. Which groups act on which space, and if a group does act on space, what does it tell about them? So just a second, let me change my color. Right. So the space we look at is the tree, so which is a connected graph without cycles. So we will consider which groups, we will consider this question for which group acts on which space. Here we take it to be a tree. And then if a group does act on its tree, what does it tell about the group? So as I mentioned before, one thing to mention is a group action on a tree is free. So if the stabilizers are trivial, that means that any non-trivial element of the group preserves any does not preserve any vertex or any edge. We have to consider both for vertex and edge because tree is essentially V, E. It consists of both vertices and both edges. So also one more thing. So this is not a free action. For example, suppose I have a V1, V2, and this E. Suppose I have a directed graph, and this is the region. Suppose applying G to it makes it G dot V1, G dot V2, and here is your G dot E. As you notice, the orientation. So, what is it? Let's ignore the fact that it's directed. Actually, directed makes it. It makes this all pure nonsense. So, let me take. Suppose this was your E, this was your GE. Now, here you can see that we have flipped the edge, right? Suppose if we had a label, so if this goes from this, this goes from this. So we have flipped the label. Our vertices have changed. So this was suppose G dot V2. So this was G dot V2, this was G dot V2. Right. So our vertices have changed, but a free, so this is not free. Not free. Because the edge is still same. Combinatorial object. It's the same. So this is equal to this. It's still joining, but the orientation has flipped. The vertices have flipped. The vertices don't. So the group element did not preserve any vertex, but it did preserve the edge. So inversions of edges is not allowed. So that would make the action not free. So inversion. So what do we have? That. So we have two conditions essentially in a free. So preserves. So this means is free. This essentially means two things. The first is no vertex is fixed. No vertex is fixed by any non-trivial element. Non-trivial element. And the second thing is no edge inversions. No edge flipping inversions. So this means two things. So this is the number two. Essentially, a group action on a tree is free is equivalent to these two conditions. Right, so this is a theorem we concentrate on. This is what we prove. This shows the power of, this gives a compelling answer to a question that which group acts on which space and what can we tell about the group if we consider the action. So if a group G acts freely on a tree, then G is a free group. This is, right. First of all, you notice that this is actually an if and only if condition. Why? Because the last time we considered that what's the inverse, like the opposite condition? It's if G is a free group, then G must act freely on a tree. But we know that if G is a free group, then by the last construction, by previous class, the previous lecture's construction, we saw that its scaly graph is also a tree. And since it acts by left multiplication, that implies the action is free action. So the inverse is also true. If G is a free group, then a group G acts freely on a tree. But this, so that we already proved. So we get that this is an if and only if condition, but, and we have already proved one side. So we proved the second side today that if G groups act, if G group acts freely on any tree, then G is a free group. Right. So also a free action of a G on a tree, suppose H is a subgroup of G, then a free action of G on a tree restricts to a free action of H on the tree, on that exact tree. Hence, we get this theorem, which is known as the Nielsen theorem. A subgroup of a free group is a free group. This is not easy to prove algebraically. And first, before proving this theorem, we give some examples where we can use our theorem. The first theorem, that is, if the G is a, G acting freely on a tree is equivalent to G is a free group. So consider SL2Z. This is the group of 2 cross 2 matrices. So SL2Z is the group of 2 cross 2 matrices with integer entries and which have determinant 1. This is not a free group because it has non-trivial elements of finite order. Find them. Find some of them. So find a 2 cross 2 integral matrix with determinant equal to 1, but it has finite order. That is a to the power m is equal to your identity 1001. So this is not a free group, SL2Z, but it has many finite index subgroups which are free. That's what we proved now. So consider this map SL2Z to SL2Z mod nZ. So every entry we reduce it modulo m. So after reducing it modulo m, so for example, we have take any 4, what would this be? No, I need a difference of 1, right? 4, 3, 1, 11, let's take that. 4, 3, 11, 1. So this belongs to SL2Z, right? 12 minus 1. And suppose I take modulo 5, then this will be 4, this will be 1, this will be 1, this is a 3. So this maps to this, so under this map. So this is a map. Denote the kernel by SL2ZM. The group of 2 cross 2. So what is SL? So the kernel will be the matrices in SL2Z which map to identity in your SL2Z mod nZ. So this is the group of 2 cross 2 matrices with integral entries and determinant equal to 1 which are identity modulo m. So for example, suppose I'm taking mod 3, then so something like 4, 4, let me take a simple example. So this maps to 1001. There will be many more examples, of course. So if I take, so instead of 0, if I only consider 3, right? So this maps to 1001 and this is belongs to SL2Z. So this is in the kernel essentially. This belongs to SL2ZM. Right. M equal to 3 here. Right. So these are the integral matrices, determinant 1, which are identity modulo M. We call these level M congruous subgroups. There is a reason for that. I'll not mention it. This has finite index because by first isomorphism theorem, the index of kernel in, so by the first isomorphism theorem, SL2Z mod, the quotient by this kernel is isomorphic to SL2, is your image, and this is a surjection, surjective map, right, is isomorphic to SL2Z mod nZ, and so basically the index of SL2Z, the index of the kernel in your SL2Z is equal to the cardinality of SL2Z mod MZ, but this is finite. Why is this finite? Because you have to fill 2 cross 2 matrices. So for each entry, there are finitely many choices. That is many choices. So this is finite, hence the index of the kernel, that is SL2ZM in SL2Z, is also finite. We prove this theorem that for m greater than or equal to 3, the SL2ZM is a free group. Now, if you first encounter this problem, like algebraically, there is no reason as such that why should SL2ZM be a free group, right? By this description that the group, it's a group of 2 cross 2 integral matrices, determinant 1 and which are identity modulo m. Why should this be a free group? So this is a nice result. This is not obvious. So we prove this theorem by analyzing its action on a tree called the Faraday tree. So Faraday tree looks like this. I'll explain the construction in a moment. So first, so that's the plan of today's talk. We first construct the Faraday tree. Then we give a proof of the theorem that if G acts freely on a tree, then it's a free group. Then we show that SL2ZM acts freely on this tree. SL2ZM acts freely on Faraday tree to prove this theorem that SL2ZM is a free group. So this is the plan of today's talk. So, okay, just a side note that even SL2Z acts on this tree. That's how we get the action of SL2ZM on the tree. We just restrict the action of SL2Z to this subgroup. But this action is not free. So this action is not free, but if we study the action of trees carefully, we'll be able to give exact presentation of this group. So if we consider the steps carefully, so what we'll be able to do is give exact presentations of group acting on trees without the freeness condition. So if we drop the freeness condition, but add something to it, that suppose we add that there were no edge inversions. Instead of the group acting freely, which consisted of two parts, if we only add that edge inversion part, then we'll be able to say something, and ultimately we'll be able to show that SL2Z has a following presentation. Just a second. This presentation, a comma b is generated by two elements, such that order of one element is 4, order of second element is 6, and a square equal to b cube for the two elements. So, however, we will not show the contents of this note, of course, because the time constraints. We will only restrict to this plan here. So, we will construct the Faraday tree now and give a proof of the theorem, and then we'll prove that SL2ZM is free by the group action. So, Faraday tree. So, Faraday tree actually pop naturally in mathematics and can be constructed using two auxiliary objects. So, first we construct a Faraday graph. Then we get a Faraday. Then we construct Faraday complex from the Faraday graph, and then we construct the Faraday tree from the Faraday complex. So, what's a Faraday graph? The construction is let's say we have elements belonging to Z2. So m comma n belongs to Z2 is primitive if the GCD of modulo of both the elements is 1, and note that GCD of n comma 0 is m, not anything else. So 1 comma 0 is one valid option, 0 comma 1 if you may. So we say m comma n belong to Z2 is primitive if GCD of mod m comma mod n is equal to 1. And we define an equivalence relation on these primitive elements of Z2 by declaring m comma n equivalent to minus m comma n. So we are identifying these pairs sine ways. So for example, 1 comma 0 is 1 comma 0 and minus 1 comma 0, we are identifying them to be the same. Or we have 2 comma 1 and minus 2 comma 1, minus 2 comma 1 to be the same element. Now, this is an equivalence relation. You can just check it. It's easy. Since this is it's just exclusive to your element m comma n, this sign does not change your inside elements. I mean, it just changes up to a sign, and we are considering GCD mod m comma mod. Right. So this is an equivalence relation. So we get equivalence classes. What does this equivalence classes consist of? These primitive elements, and in each class you have the plus and minus version of that primitive element. So the Faraday graph is a graph. Vertices are essentially the equivalence classes. That is a set m comma n belonging to Z2 such that mn primitive up to your equivalence relation. So we can denote the vertex by plus minus m comma n. So each vertex is plus minus m comma n. That's how we denote it. And now we have these vertices plus minus m comma n plus minus a comma. So we have these vertices plus minus. So we get these vertices now plus minus 1 comma 0, plus minus 0 comma 1, plus minus 1 comma 1, plus minus 1 comma minus 1, plus minus 2 comma 1. And how do we get the edges between them? So we say plus minus p comma q and plus minus r comma s are connected by an edge. If this determinant, first we consider PQ and then we consider RS, is equal to plus minus 1. If the determinant of this matrix is plus minus 1, then we consider that there is an edge between plus minus P, Q and plus minus R, S. For example, here, these two will be connected by an edge, right? Because this forms an identity matrix, 1, 0, 0, 1. And this will be connected by an edge. Because this forms the determinant will be this 1, 0, and then will be 1, 1. The determinant of this is equal to 1. So this, there will be an edge between these. There will be an edge between these. Yeah. Right, so let's move on. So, so before seeing how the ferret graph looks like, let's see how does SL2Z adapt on it. So as I said, the action of SL, the level M congruent subgroup of SL2Z will be constructed by first getting an action of SL2Z and then restricting it to that subgroup. So of course, like if you have these, we have these vertices which correspond to your, to Z, which belong to Z2, right? And we have SL2Z, so we act by, SL2Z acts on it by matrix multiplication. So just a second. By matrix multiplication. So let A belong to SL2Z and given a vertex plus minus P comma Q, then the so A acts on plus minus PQ. So there so plus minus PQ is mapped to this plus minus this vertex. So whatever this so A matrix, so this is a matrix multiplication P comma PQ, considered as a column vector, and this is what it maps to. So to prove this is an action on the tree, we will have to show two things. First of all, it's well-defined action on the set of vertices. And then we'll have to show that the action preserves adjacency and the non-adjacency of the vertices. And this, so it's an easy calculation to show that it is indeed the case that your action preserves your two vertices which are adjacent and non-adjacent. So hence SL2Z acts on it, fair enough. Of course, it's by matrix multiplication. Now, how do we construct the Fairey complex? So, the Fairey complex is essentially, or actually, let's first see how the Fairey graph looks like, right? Okay. So, start with vertices plus minus 1, comma 0 and plus minus 0, comma 1. So, let me write it. So start with vertices plus minus 1 comma 0 and plus minus 0 comma 1. So say I start with this, this is 1 comma 0 plus minus 1 comma 0 and this is plus, sorry, plus minus, this is 0 comma 1. Right, now let's see what vertices are connected to both of these. So first of all, there is obviously is an edge between these, right? Because the determinant form is equal to plus one, right? So there is a, there exists an edge between these two. Let's see what all vertices are connected to both of these. So we want plus minus a comma b, such that this one, so 1 0, a b, this determinant is equal to plus minus one, and 0 1. A, B, this determinant is equal to plus minus 1. This means B equal to plus minus 1. This means A equal to plus minus 1. So, up to your signs, you get two vertices connected to both of these edges. Connected to both these vertices. Both these vertices, that is plus minus 1 comma 0 and plus minus 0 comma 1. So these are essentially your vertices. This is plus minus 1 comma 1 and second one is plus minus minus 1 comma 1. So so here for example you can see that 1 comma minus 1 is also a vertex, but this is just negative of, so this the minus 1 comma 1 is just a negative of this this particular one, that this becomes 1 and this becomes minus 1, right? So you so now what we get two triangles in our graph, right? So what's our diagram looking like now? So this is plus minus 1 comma 0, this is plus minus 0 comma 1, here is 1 comma 1, and here is plus minus minus 1 comma 1. This, Right. Now, so now basically look at one of the edge and ask which vertices are connected with it. So suppose I look at this edge. So suppose I take this edge, 10211. Suppose I take this edge and I want to know what vertices are connected to this. Again, you can repeat, like it's an easy calculation. So let's just do it for this one, then we can observe a pattern what's happening actually. So that will be, so connected to this edge, so that would mean that you have 10AB and 11A. So this determinant is equal to what, B. This is determinant is equal to B minus A. So this is equal to plus minus 1. This is equal to plus minus 1. Implies we get vertices. Plus minus 2 comma 0 and plus minus, so 0 comma 1. Right. But we already had this vertex, right? Plus minus 0 comma 1, because like look here, you get, we want to know, so this edge, and you have this vertex connecting to this edge, right? You can see there are two edges here and here. So we get a new vertex, which is plus minus 2 comma 0. Now, so we generalize this procedure. Anytime we have an edge, we get a new vertex corresponding to any edge. So we take an edge, we consider a new vertex, and we keep adding it. We can keep adding the new vertices. Now, what's happening actually? Let's observe something. So note this. So one comma one, right? What's 1 comma 1? This is 1 comma 0 plus 0 comma 1. And what is this? Minus 1 comma 0 plus 0 comma 1. So we are, so first of all, we added, so we add these two vectors, 1 comma 0 and 0 comma 1. And that's what we started with, the h was corresponding to. And we added, if we add these two vertices pairwise, this component wise, then we get one of the vertex, and if we add another representation of the same two vertices, we get this edge. But let's see if it's happening here too. Okay, what's about 2 comma 0? What's this? 1 comma 0 plus 1 comma 1. What is this? This is 0 comma 1. So this is 0 comma 1 plus, wait a second, sorry. This should be minus 1. This is not 0 comma 1. The two edges we started with were plus minus 1 comma 0 and 1 comma 1. So that's minus 1 comma 0 plus 1 comma 1. So this one minus comes out. Right. So why is it happening? Why do we have that the new vertices are essentially the pair, the component wise addition of our appropriate representations of your vectors? Why is it happening? Anyway, anyone? Just observe why, like, what are we doing essentially? We are taking an edge. Suppose this was P comma Q. This was plus minus R comma S. And we want to find a vertex. We want to find vertices which are connected to both these vertices, right? So we need this edge, these edges. So what do we want? That these determinants are plus minus 1. So what determinants? Such that first of all, you have, suppose this was A comma B. This is what we wanted. P, Q and R S are given. A, P and P, Q is equal to plus minus 1. And I wanted a vertex AB such that R is equal to plus minus 1, right? I wanted these conditions. But no, there existed an edge between PQ and RS already. So we had this condition that PQ and RS is equal to plus minus 1. But you know about matrices, right? That column, if we add two columns to, So given C1 and C2, if we replace the columns by C1 plus C2 and C1, and C2, sorry, then that won't change your determinant. So that would mean that you can get two matrices like P minus R, Q minus S, and the second vertex is RS. This is also equal to plus minus one, your determinant, and P plus R, Q minus S, R, S. This is also equal to plus minus one. Now, you can say like, okay, I get these two, so this serves as your A comma B, right? Now, so this is also an A comma B. I mean, you can do the same thing. So for example, like for this, you have now, if we add the same thing, if we add the same thing to your second column, we'll get P, Q, P plus R, Q plus S equal to plus minus one. So you get that P plus R, if this is equal to A, this is equal to B, then PQ AB is equal to plus minus one and AB RS is equal to plus minus one. So you get one such AB, and for P, for corresponding to this, since we are allowing plus minus, so up to sign changes, everything is allowed. So we get a, so we get two vertices, plus minus A comma B and plus minus C comma D, so start, which are connected to these two vertices. But you may ask, but we can also do this, right? P, Q, and suppose I add P plus 2R or something like that, 2S, RS, right? Something of that manner, right? Suppose I do something like this, this, right? And then 2PQ, 2P plus 2R, 2Q plus 2S, and PQ. But the thing is, okay, first of all, does this work? So one more thing you have to consider, you are considering only primitive elements. So there cannot be any prime factor. So there cannot be any common factor between these two elements, right? If that makes some sense. So let me confirm that. But essentially, you get only two such, because of all the restrictions, you get only two such elements, such that you get only two such elements, A comma B and C comma D, such that these such that they are connected to both these vertices. And one corresponds to addition of the two representatives, and one corresponds to addition of, so negative of one, negative of one, and just adding the another representative. So it will be essentially P plus R, Q plus S, and the second one will be P minus R plus, and the second component is Q minus S. So I hope this is clear. So how do we get new vertices? So our procedure now, the algorithm to get the graph is, so anytime we have an edge, so anytime we have an edge, so we get new vertices. Corresponding to adding two components, adding components of the vertices of the edge we started with, of the vertices of the edge we started with, and adding, of course, adding appropriate representatives of the vertices of the edge we started with. And this happens because we can do this, because column operations don't affect the determinant. Right, and we need that both, and the new vectors are primitive, like their GCD is also one. So to get that, so like for example, in that case, we have 2P plus 2R and 2Q plus 2S, right? But that means both the GCD of both them are now 2, right? But that's not allowed. So we can get exactly two vertices. This gives the, so this is the inductive procedure to get clarity. Right. Now, just a second. So let me add the page, let me switch to color. So essentially what we are doing, we get two vertices. Let me draw this a little better. And for this edge, we already had, so suppose I consider this edge, then we already had one vertex corresponding to it. We'll get a second vertex by this. Then the second vertex corresponding to this edge, this edge, this edge. Then for this edge, you get like this, 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 and so on. Let me just complete this cycle, right, and so on. So this is the ultimate picture you get. So that's what you get. So you can observe like this is 1, 0, this is 0, 1, you get, so this is a straight line. Let me highlight it. This is a straight edge between them. Then this is -1, 1, here everything is of course +-1, 0, +-0, 1, but here they are not written it. So this edge, this is their edge, this is their edge. Then we added one new vertex and so on. Now you can note one thing, each vertex is connected to infinitely many vertices. Pick any, so because suppose I pick this, right, at the time it is formed, then so pick any vertex at the time it is formed, it will correspond to your, it's formed from an edge, so like this, it's formed like this, so there was an edge and this vertex was formed, then given this edge you get this new vertex. Then consider this edge, you get one new vertex, so on. So each, so this, 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 and this, like it's continuing. So each vertex you can observe is connected to infinitely many other vertices. Just a second. So you can consider this, for example. So this is the normal one we consider, 0, 1. If you can observe one thing for that, the ferrograph is look same from any vertex. What do we mean by that? Okay, first of all, let's check one more thing. We need to check one thing, right? We define the, what's a ferrograph? A ferrograph is a graph whose vertices are these +-n, where m and n are primitive, and we have given a procedure to construct a graph. Now we need to show that this procedure gives exactly our ferrograph. That is, we need to show, so to check, this gives a whole ferrograph. This gives a whole ferrograph. That is, by this procedure we can get every m comma n which is primitive ferrograph. So first, now, essentially what you can do is, So how can we show this, that this gives the whole ferrograph? So the first process, the first thing we need to check that, for everything we can first of all consider 1, 0. So first we can check that this process draws all edges emanating from +-1, 0. And this is easy to check, right? Which one are those? Like which ones are those? So we want 1, 0 and PQ to be equal to +-1. We want Q is equal to +-1. But your P can be anything, right? P can be anything. P belongs to Z. So you get all these edges. So you can check that you can get this vertex. For example, you can start with 1, 0. So first of all, you get us this 0, 1, right? Then we show that we can get 1, 1, then 2, 1, and similarly, if we consider the edge joining 1, 0 and 2, 1, the next edge will be the addition of component wise. It will be 3, 1, 4, 1, and similarly, if we consider from this side, these will be 1, -1, and of course, everything is plus minus of this, plus minus this, and so on. So 2, -1, 3, -1, 4, -1. Right. So we get all these vertices. So first thing is that we already that we have checked that this process draws all edges emanating from plus minus 1, 0. Now, how do we prove that this is now true for every element of every vertex? That would show that the whole we have obtained the whole paragraph, right? So that is shown using the action. We had that SL2Z acts on the paragraph. I've already by matrix multiplication, as I've trained, as I've told you. Now, show there exists an element. So there exists A belonging to SL2Z such that A dot V is equal to plus minus 1, 0. So such that your matrix A carries any vertex B to your vertex 1, 0. So this such an action is called a transitive action, right? So this is a transitive action that you have that there exists some element A belonging to SL2Z such that A carries B to your plus minus 1, 0. So once you so what this does is you have V, you go to 1, +-1, 0 using your A, everything is corrected here, you have all the edges completed, go back using A inverse, and then you get that V has all the edges, right? So that this shows that the whole process gives you exactly your paragraph. So just fill in the details of the proof. So you have to show this, this is not hard, this is easy, right? Let's move on. This is the end of the page, right? Now, the Faraday complex. Now, what do we have in the Faraday graph, first of all? Let me paste a picture again. Yeah, this is a Faraday graph, right? Now, sorry. And let me highlight a region. So you have this, so you have these triangular regions, right? This triangular region, for example. And suppose you have, and for example, you have this triangular region. Yeah, these infinitely many, so your whole graph is made of these triangular regions, and you have these edges making up the edges of your triangle. So what, how do we, so second, the second auxiliary object was the Faraday complex. So attach disks to these triangular regions. So basically fill these triangular regions up by attaching a disk to it, so this is called a, when you attach, so these disks that you attach are called two sets. This is just a notation, like if you don't go into like CW complexes, etc. But you attach these disks to it. So basically you fill up the graph by these disks. The boundary of each disk is the boundary of your triangle. So along the boundary of your triangle, you fill up the interior. Now notice one thing, because the process gave us exactly the whole Faraday graph. We observed that every edge, so first of all, let me write it here, fill up the triangular regions using disks. Let me just write it in bracket two sets. So now notice something, that every edge is contained in exactly two triangles, because to every edge you can get two vertices, right? Like this. So each edge is contained in two triangles, and now they are filled triangles. They're not just a boundary of the triangle, you have a filled triangle now. So near any point, if you observe from here, suppose you observe from here, this looks like a plane. Near every point, your whole graph locally looks like a plane, right? Because if you sit here, let me use a different color. Suppose if you sit in this and you take a neighborhood of it, it looks like a plane locally. Now, that's what a fairy complex is, that you have, that you fill up these triangular regions of your fairy graph using disks. Now, what about the action of SL2Z? Well, the same action carries forward to your, the same action induces your action on your fairy complex. Since the boundary of triangles are mapped to boundary of another triangles in the action on fairy graph. So what do we have? That so we add these two regions, right? So in your fairy graph, this edge suppose goes to here, and this edge goes to this one, this edge goes to this one. So in your fairy graph action, you add that these boundaries of triangles map to each other. So now, since you have one boundary mapping to each other, you can just take an induced mapping of the inside triangle to the other. So suppose, let me just write. So suppose this was your triangle, and this was your triangle, and this boundary is mapped to this. You can just take the action of the disk to this. Just join everything by a straight line, like this is this. Everything up to scaling is so. I hope you get the point, that you can just induce the same action. Once you have that, the boundary maps to of one triangle maps to another one, you can get that the inside disk also maps to the another. Right. I have to finish by 3:30, so I'll just speed it up a little bit. Right, so since we get that the boundaries of triangles is mapped to boundary of another one, we get that that SL2Z acts on a fairy complex. Again, let me add another picture of fairy. So now what do we have? Now what do we have? We have two types of things in our fairy graph. First of all, we have fairy complex now. Complex. So you have these interiors of these triangles, and you have these edges. So the whole fairy complex is comprised of two such objects. One is the interior of these triangles, and one are the edges of these triangles, the boundary components. Now, how do we form the fairy tree? The fairy tree. Now, the fairy tree, the vertices will be. So, what do you do? Is essentially, for example, you had this triangular region, right? You take a vertex in this triangular region. So you take this vertex. So there are two types of vertices. The first type is in the middle of the edge. The middle means like just the middle of the edge. I'm not explaining it more. So the second type is the one corresponding to your interior, in the centroid of your triangle, This is your essentially the one corresponding to your interior. So for example, here there will be an edge here, this corresponds to the interior, this, right? So you get the point. Now, edges. So the edges, sorry, edges. So connect to vertices when there is a containment relation. That is containment relation. What does it mean? Containment relation. That is there exists an edge when the vertex of so for example, let me explain it through example. So there is an containment. So for example, this vertex, this vertex is contained in this triangle, right? So connect these two. So each interior is connected to these three, like this, is connected to the three vertices which correspond to its boundary edges. Then for example here, now this will be connected to this, this and this. So notice something. First of all, each interior is connected to three boundary points. The three boundary points corresponding to the boundary of the triangle, and each edge, since it is contained in exactly two triangles, so each edge vertex, I mean the vertex corresponding to your edge in your ferric complex, is connected to two interior vertices. This is connected to this, this is connected to this, this, and so on. So edges are the containment relation. Let me paste a picture of the Faraday complex now. Sorry, the Faraday tree. So this is a Faraday tree. Notice, for example, here you have two types of edges. So this one corresponds to the edge. These three correspond to the edge. This corresponds to the interior. So you connect this by this, this by this, this by this, and similarly for other. So you get this whole tree now. Bisected. So first of all, you have to confirm that this is a tree. So let me draw this. So this looks like this, 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 yeah, this, 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 this. And so on. And similarly on the other side. This too. Right. So this is a Faraday, the Faraday tree. This is how we construct it. So some things to note, some observations. So a vertex exists, so notice something, that your vertex corresponding to your edge is connected to two vertices which correspond to interiors. So for example, this was an edge vertex, then because of course one vertex type, one edge type vertex cannot be connected to another edge type vertex. So the edge type vertex vertices are connected to your interior type vertices, and similarly one interior type vertices is connected to three vertex type vertices. So two interior type vertices cannot be connected to each other. So if there is any confusion in this construction, just let me know right now, because it will be later to clarify later. Like, since we are doing it right now, you can just ask me now, or I'll move on within 1 minute. All right. Just notice something. The edges are diverging, right? So the edges are diverging from each other at any point. This is some kind of hyperbolic structure on your graph. I'll not explain what that means, but just take it as something. So you have to prove that this is a tree. So to prove this is a, so now you have to prove this is a tree, since we claim this is a Faraday tree. So to prove this is a tree, first of all, show. So what do we need to show? To show something is a tree, show there is a unique path between any two vertices, right? But since our action was transitive, so the same action carries from the Faraday complex to your Faraday tree. So since the action was transitive, we can just show there is a unique path between 1 comma 0 and 0 comma 1. This corresponds, this means that edges diverge. Because of course, unique path between the edge, show that there is just a unique path between, this is a Faraday tree, between any vertex and the vertex corresponding to edge 1 comma 0 connected to 0 comma 1. That is, you have to show that any vertex can be reached to this vertex. So for example, take any vertex here, there exists a unique path, this corresponds to the fact that they are edges diverge. So try proving this. This is an exercise. Prove this is a tree. This is actually a tree. There exists a unique path. This is not hard. You can just follow your definition from earlier, the paragraph and etc. Let me change the page. All right. That's the construction of our. This was the construction of Faraday tree. So as I said, first we prove the construction. First we show the construction of the Faraday tree. And now, what do we have now? We have a Faraday tree. And we have SL to Z acting on Faraday. This action is induced by on Faraday graph. So the action on Faraday graph was by matrix multiplication. Then we constructed a Faraday complex by filling in this to the boundary of the triangle. The action induced was carried forward since any boundary of a triangle mapped to another boundary of a triangle, and then we constructed this tree of two types of vertices. One type of vertices are these corresponding to your edge, and one type of vertices are corresponding to your integral of a triangle. By the way, just a thing. So this construction of adding vertices, one for each edge and one for each interior, is a part of a general construction called a dual of a complex. So for example, we had the Faraday complex here. So this is a general construction called the dual of the complex, where you add vertices corresponding to each region. So for example, we have two types of region, one for each edge and one for each interior, right? And then we have the edges. The edges are essentially your containment relation edges. So if our vertex is contained in a triangle, then we connect that the vertex of that edge to the vertex of the interior, and so on. And now we get that SL to Z acts on the Faraday. Now, the second part, as I promised, is to prove the theorem. So now we prove that if G acts on a tree T freely, this tree can be any tree, not exactly your Cayley graph, or this Faraday tree. This can be any tree. Then we have to show freely. Then we will show that G is free. Now, how do we prove it? Proof. Now, okay, let's first of all take an example in mind. We have this F2. You know, F2 acts freely on a point, freely on its Cayley graph, right? So that is a tree of the Faraday graph, the Cayley graph of F2. It's nice to always have an example in mind. So like this, and you have this, small one, this. And so on. Right. So F2, we know that F2 acts on this freely. It's just an example in mind that we will use to visualize what steps we are doing. So what we do is, first step is, we prove this in three steps. So we will prove, the theorem in three steps. First is, we tile the tree. What setting we have in? G is acting freely on a tree. We tile the tree using some manner. We will show what that is. The second thing will be, to show that, to find a generating set, from the tree. From the tiling. So first we tile the tree in some manner, tile in the sense that, I'll show you what that tile means. So for example, if you had this graph, say, this 0, 0, and so on, like here. So a tiling, So a tiling would be of this form. Say we consider this is one tile, then this is one tile, this is one tile. So for example, you can tile your plane by these squares, right? Like this, So this is an example of a tiling. I'll state what a tiling is formally. So what we do is first tile the tree. Second is if we find a generating set from the tiling. Third is prove that the generating set we found was a free generating set. That it free. There is no relation between the free generating set. There was no relation between the generators. So that's the three things we do. So let's first tile the tree. What does a tile mean? This is a formal definition of a tile. Tiling. First is tiling the tree. Okay, I have half an hour left, so I'll just speed it up a little more. First is the definition of a tile. What is a tile? A tile is a subtree of barycentric. I'll explain what it means. Subdivision T dash of. So first of all, what is a barycentric subdivision? So given a tree of this form, say like this, so this is a tree. These are its vertices. So what we are doing is barycentric subdivision means in each edge, add one edge in the middle of it. So subdivision is adding new vertices. So how do we subdivide the tree? We add new vertices in the middle of every edge. And the subtree of this would be, so now we want a subtree of this, and it would look like, say, like for example, this is one tile. So this is one tile. This is a subtree of the barycentric subdivision. So for example, if you want to tile your whole tree using different, so this will be one subtree, and this will be one subtree, this will be one subtree. Let's say this hole is covered by one tile. This. So what does it mean? So for example, in our F2 case, so this was your F2, like this was your F2, and so on. So what do we do? Let me use a different color. So for example, this is one tile. This we can take to be a one tile. So we take these vertices which correspond to a barycentric subdivision. We subdivide these edges, and this is one tile. And then basically we can continue like this. This is one more tile. 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 So I hope the idea of tiling is clear to you. We subdivide a tree by adding new vertices in between the edges, and then we consider subtrees of it. So, let me just here. So that's what is the definition of a tile. What is tiling? a collection of trees such that first union so collection of tiles sorry a collection of tiles it's just what you expect it to be collection of tiles such that union of tiles is your whole tree union of tiles is equal to your the whole tree t dash that is your baricentric subdivision that you get a whole tree in this manner second is interior of tiles can only are either disjoint or can intersect only in vertices can intersect only in vertices that is there is no so this means that there is no overlapping in your tiles so suppose this was a tile your next tile cannot be like this so each tile is so this is one tile the second tile will either be disjoint or it will be connected to this vertex so they do not overlap these except on a vertex so tiling means that each region is assigned to one tile and then you have one more tile except the intersections can at most be a vertex so for example here this red tile and this red tile do not intersect but this blue tile and red tile intersect in a vertex so that's your definition of a tiling it's a collection of tile first of all the whole tree should be covered the second is that interior of two tiles are either disjoint two tiles are either disjoint and the intersection can be at most a vertex right let me add a page now what's a, so now this is a normal tiling of your tree but we have an action of g on your tiles right we want to utilize that part of it too in a tiling we want to represent that tiling we want to have some part of that g in a tiling so what's a so we define a g tiling this is a tiling of the tree according to a group g which means a g tiling of a tree is a tiling such that there exists a t naught tile tile t naught which we'll label t naught such that the set of tiles is equal to g t naught so g dot t naught so that means for example in our f2 example this was like this and this so your first of all your tiling one of the tiling was like this right and then you had like this and so on like this so for example in this case I have a I can find a tile t naught I say this red tile is t naught and what's the action of so this is the Cayley graph of g of f2 right so the action of this on this tree is by left multiplication so this is a tile t naught so every other tile looks at g dot t naught so this was the vertex corresponding to a this was vertex corresponding to ab this ab inverse so since this is e so this going from so we you can go from this tile to this tile by a times t naught right this tile to this tile by b times b inverse times t naught I hope you get the idea of what g tiling is so this is b dot t naught sorry t naught going from red to this one is a inverse dot t naught so there exists a tile and for example like here will be like a shorter one like this so going from here to here it will be ab times t naught so there exists some tile t naught such that all other tiles are similar to it and you so that the set of tiles is exactly g dot t naught so this means two things so this condition means two things first of all every g naught is a tile every g dot t naught is a tile the second is each tile is of the form g dot t naught is of form g dot t naught so that means the set of the tiles is exactly equal to g dot t naught where g belongs to your group element and this dot represents your action so first of all we define the tiling of a tree and then we said we wanted tiling such that it has some part of g in it so we define it g tiling so this is a tiling such that there exists some t naught some basic some fundamental domain some So a tile T naught, such that all the tiles are just translates of this single tile by the elements of the by the group elements. Right. Now we've okay. Now let's find a G tiling of T dash. G tiling of T dash. How do we do that? So first of all, T dash is just your basic iterative subdivision, right? Because that's where we have a tile. We have a vertex in between of this edge, so we can consider these sides. So first of all, the first thing to note is the action of G on that original tree T induces an action G on T dash. So for example, you had, suppose this edge going to this edge, then you add a new vertex here. This vertex must go to the vertex here between the edge. So first of all, the action of G on your tree T induces a action of G on your tree T dash. So second, now we want to find a G tiling of T dash. So let V belonging to T dash be an arbitrary vertex. For example, here we can take your for example in case of T this scaling graph, you can take this to be your arbitrary vertex and then construct a tile around it. And then have that all other tiles are translates of this one tile. So let but we want to do this for any arbitrary graph. So let V belonging to D dash be an arbitrary vertex. We know G acts freely on this tree, freely on T dash. So what does that mean? You have V. We have G, so G1V, G2V, and for all these elements in G. You have these, you have this G and dot, whatever your final G dot V, right? So, and what does freely means? That no non-trivial element fixes your G, fixes your V, right? So that means each, so this G1 dot V is not, and we know that means G1 dot V is not equal to V. And this is not equal to V. So all these are different endpoints. So that means the points in orbit of V are in one-to-one correspondence, with elements of G, So for that means for each point in the orbit, you have a element G such that it's G dot V, and for each element G, you can go to the orbit by considering G dot V. This we may not have. So suppose this may not have been the condition if G did not act freely, because suppose G3 dot V fixed your G3 dot V was again your V, then we will not have this condition, because obviously we will not have one-to-one correspondence with your elements of G. So the points in orbit, so this is an observation that points in orbit of V are in one-to-one correspondence with the elements of G. Now what do we do? You have this tree T, right? So here, like here, this was a, for example, this was a, we chose this to be V. This is the example we are keeping in mind till now. And this is what? This is A dot V. This is B dot V. This is B inverse dot, A inverse dot V. This is B inverse dot V. So how do we construct a tile in this region? Well, we, so this is B A inverse dot V, right? So how do we construct a tile? So we have this Bayes interdivision. Now we consider all the points on the edges which are closest to your point G dot V. So this is a tile. So this is consists of points which are closest to your V, closer to V than any of your other B dot V or A dot V. For example, here this tile would be essentially all the points which are closest to A dot V other than any G dot V. So that's how you construct a G tiling. So that's a construction. So each tile is a set of points. Of T dash that are closest to G dot V than any other G dash dot. So for example, let me just repeat this example. So for example, look at this diagram. So this was your E, this was A dot V, this was B dot V. So for example, you can see all these tiles are the ones that are closest to this V. Then all the points here in this tile are the ones that are closest to A dot V. So as you can see, that's how, then any other G dot V. So for G belonging, so for G belonging to G, let TG be the tile, so basically whose vertex set, whose vertex set is equal to W belonging to T dash, such that this is just the condition we wrote, that it's closest to G dot V, then any other is less than equal to distance between W and G dash dot V for all G dash dot V. So it's closest to G dot V. So that's what we define TG to be. So for example, here, this is TE, the identity, so we denote it by T naught. This is TA, this will be TB, this is TB inverse, and this is TA inverse. And of course, here it will be like this. This will be TAA and so on. We add a page. And we have given a vertex set and the edges and whose edge set, is the set of vertices joined by other vertices such that both lie in TG. So basically, for example, suppose we had this was a TG, like let's take another example. Suppose this was your TG for some. Suppose this was a T dash, this example. We get that this is a. Suppose these were vertices lying in TG. This, and this. So the edge sets will be the vertices which are totally joining those vertices which are totally contained in your TG. So for example, you get this vertex, you'll get this vertex, get this vertex, you'll get this vertex, but you won't get this vertex. Why? Because one lies in TG, other does not. Right. So this is the edge set. The vertex set is essentially the points which are closest to your G dot V, then any other G dash dot V, and the edge set is the one joining vertices which are totally lying in your TG. Now, claim the set of TG is a G tile. This is the claim we want to show, that this TG is essentially a G tile. First, so three things to check are TG is a tile. Now we have, what's a tile? It's a subtree of the Bayesian subdivision. So to prove this, this is a subtree. No, T dash was a tree, right? T dash was a tree. Now to show it is a subtree, we only need to check it is a connected subgraph. Because then the tree of the subtree will automatically follow. If it's a subgraph, because T dash was a tree and this is a connected subgraph of it. And if T dash did not contain any cycle, how can its subgraph contain any cycle? So that will prove that it's a connected subgraph of without any cycle. That would prove it is a subtree. So we need to show that each TG is a connected subgraph. Now, how much time do we have left? 15 minutes. I'll just run through the proof. All right. Or actually, you can basically try to prove this on your own. This is easy one, that this is a connected subgraph. Basically, what you have to do, consider a unique path between any two points and do an induction on the length of the paths. So prove this. A ticket is an exercise. A TG is a type. Second, the second thing you have to prove union of TG is whole T dash. So to prove every vertex lies in some TG. Now, how do you show that? So basically, how do you show that is like this. So we want to show that every vertex lies inside some TG. So we want to show that every vertex is closer to some GV than any other G dash V. That is obvious. So not to prove this. So now every vertex, we know that every vertex is closer to some GV other than some G dash V. So we have to prove. To prove every edge has endpoints containing in same TG. That's how containing in same TG. So for example, this was your edge. If you have to show that the whole graph lies in your union of TGs, you have to show that suppose this belonged to your T3, then this should also have been should have belonged to your T3. Because suppose it belonged to T2, then this edge would have not corresponded to any TG. We want to show the union of TGs, the whole T dash. So we want to show that these two, so the endpoints correspond to the same TG. So proof. So the proof of this. So every hatch has a, so every edge has a vertex U coming from some TI. So now what do you have? So every edge, each edge has a vertex U coming from coming from the pericentric division TH. So for example, if you have, whenever you consider an edge, you must have that this was a part of your edge, for example. So this was your original edge. You added a pericentric division, was adding new vertices in between, right? In the middle of the edge. So each edge now has one vertex which we added now, which is, belongs to the pericentric division, and one type of vertex which is coming from the original tree. So every edge path alternates between these two types of vertices. So that means each edge path alternates between these two types of vertices. One is from pericentric division and one is from original tree, then pericentric division, then original tree. So that means suppose U was coming from original tree, W was coming from your pericentric division, then suppose distance of U to your orbit of V was equal to even, then that implies distance of W to your orbit must be odd. Because the edge path essentially alternates between these two types of vertices U and W. So this in particular means distances are not equal. Now, suppose distance of U to your orbit, of V was smaller and it lied in TG. It belonged to TG. That implies distance of U to your orbit is U belonging to your TG would mean that this distance U to orbit is essentially the distance U to G dot V, because TG is a TG consists of vertices that are closer to G dot V than any other vertex. So this distance is equal to G dot V. Distance of U to a set A is essentially the minimum distance of U to any point of A. So that's why this is by definition. This equality is by definition. And second thing is distance of U comma GV is less than equal to distance of W GV comma GV. This is by this assumption that suppose distance of U comma v were smaller. And by triangle inequality, we have that distance of u g v. So this is so let me just erase this part. And by triangle inequality, we have that distance of w to g v is less than equal to w u to g v. Just a minute. So you just apply the triangle inequality once. So and you get that distance of v dot u comma g v is less than equal to distance of w comma g v. This is all good, sorry. Distance of w comma g v is less than equal to distance of u comma g v. That's one. This is triangle inequality. This is basically recapping your whole previous the two inequalities I wrote. So since note, so what do we get? That ultimately we get that this these two are within one of each other, right? Distance of UGV and distance of UGV plus one. And all these integers must be your integer, right? Because you're just considering distances are length of paths. It can be one, two, or something. So that means distance of w comma your orbit is equal to your distance of w comma gv because everything is an integer and the extremes are contained within one of each other. So that means that it is contained in g. It might not be very clear to me, you can just ask me. I have very less time to I'm racing through the proof. And the third part of it, we have proved that it is a tiling. Now we have to prove it is a g tiling. How do you prove that g tiling is to prove that this relation t g t h is equal to t g h. So I'll not give proofs now, just a sketch of the proof. I'll send you a proof afterwards. You can just read it on your own. It's very readable. So you prove this relation that g acting on t h is equal to t of g h. So suppose you had t naught here and you carried it to a dot t naught. Sorry. So if you had this was your t a and you carried applied B to it, then this will be your TAB. That's what it means. And how does this give you this is a G tiling? So let H be equal to identity element, sorry, H be equal to zero, then that or identity element, then G T naught is D G times identity element, that's TG. So every TG is of the form, through this relation, we get that every TG is of the form GT root. So we get that TG is a G tiling. That's what we had to prove for a G tiling. That every other tile is of the form G T naught, a translate of T naught by some element of G. Now the second thing is to find a generating set. Now, for example, in your proof for F2, in your case of F2, this was your T naught. This was your A T naught, this was your B T naught, this was your C T naught, A inverse T naught, this was your B inverse T naught. So I get that all the tiles which are just adjacent to my T naught in this case are my generating set. So this corresponding to B, this corresponded to your A, this corresponds to A inverse, B inverse. So that's what we prove in general. So this is true in general that every belonging to G such that G T naught intersection T naught is non-empty or it's equal to a vertex is a generating set. Belongs to the generating set. So we take all those G such that G T naught is adjacent to your T naught. So basically the proof of it is, suppose you're given any element G equal to S, suppose G was equal to I don't have time to prove it, so I'll just send you the proof. So this is you can just take it as a word, so that this is a generating set. All the tiles which are just adjacent to your T naught. Okay, I have 5 minutes left. Okay. The third step is to show that this is a free generating set. That will show. This shows that your G is a free group. Right. We found a generating set of So generate, we found a generating set of G using your graph, using your tiling of a graph. So again, translating your geometric properties to your algebraic properties, finding your generating set using your tiling. And we show that this is a free generating set. How do we show that? Basically, if you have, suppose, G equal to S1, S2 till Sn, then in your tree T, this would mean that you have a path. This is S1, this is your S2 till Sn. Okay, actually, let me just quickly state this short-term proof. This is not very hard. Not very lengthy. So G equal to S1 till Sn. So how do we get a, we want to get a unique. So, okay. Oh, right. I have one quick proof for this too. So given any G belonging to G, consider G dot V. So here's your V, here's your G dot V. And since we have a tree, there exists a unique path between these two vertices. That's why the definition of a tree. Now, consider all the tiles. In this edge path, let we encounter the tiles S1 dot T naught, S2 dot T naught, and so on. Till Sn dot T naught. So by suppose this was a tile, this was a tile, and suppose this was a tile, like this whole was a tile, this was a tile, this was a tile. So while going from V to GV, if we encounter S1 dot T1, S2 dot T2, and till Sn dot Tn, then we show G is equal to S1 multiplied till Sn. And since there is a unique path, there will be a unique word representing G. That would prove the free generation. And essentially, you can reverse this process. Given a G equal to S1 till Sn, you can get a path, and that path is unique. So this is just a sketch of the proof. I was not able to explain it properly. So I'll skip it for now. I'll send you a proof, a PDF of a proof. Now that proves that this proves that G is a free. Now let's just quickly show. I'll take 5 more minutes and show SL to Z, M is free. So we will show that to show this acts freely on Faraday tree. Right. So the first condition to show in free action is to show there are no edge inversions. How do we show that? Now notice that the action of SL to Z on the Faraday complex cannot interchange edge. So for example, you have, so what's a Faraday tree, right? So this is your Faraday tree. This comes back to our observation. If this was an edge corresponding to, this was a vertex corresponding to your edge, then this would have to be a vertex corresponding to your interior of a triangle, right? Obviously. Because that's how we constructed the Faraday tree. If this was a vertex corresponding to S, this was a vertex corresponding to your interior of a tree. And by the action of SL to Z on a Faraday complex, if you are multiplying, you can observe that if you are multiplying your A to your vertices, and if you consider your, so edges goes to, so basically any vertex edge goes to your vertex edge under action of A. And any interior vertex goes to your interior vertex. So these two vertices cannot be exchanged. That means that the edge cannot be flipped. There is no edge inversion.
Akshar, please try to wrap.
Yeah, just 5 minutes or so.
You can't have 5 minutes because it's 3:30 and the other top would be starting.
Yeah, just 2-3 minutes, man. Come on. Okay, what's the stabilizer of vertices? Just check stabilizer of vertices. So since the action was transitive, we only need to check for, first of all, we have two types of vertices, right? Vertices corresponding to edges. And since the action was transitive, we can only check for one vertex, the one corresponding to 1, 0, and zero. If we check for stabilizer of this vertex, then every other stabilizer of the vertex will be same. So the stabilizer of this, so basically you consider a comma b, a quick calculation like 1 0 this and so on will show you that there can only be the only stabilizer in SL to Z of this this vertex can be is one of these. There are four matrices, so this is 1 0 0 1 0 1 minus 1 0 minus 1 0 0 minus 1 and 0 minus 1 1 0. Now this is belonging in SL to Z, but we have to consider for SL to ZM. So show for all m greater than or equal to 2, it's easier to is easy to see that for all m belonging to 2, m greater than or equal to 2, only two of the above belong to SL to ZM. That is, only two of the above mod m are the identity matrix in SL to ZM. So that is, and these two are essentially your identity and minus identity. This is just a calculation. And the so stabilizer of your vertices corresponding to your edges in your SL to ZM are trivial. That is identity and minus identity. Second is vertices corresponding to your interior. For that too, you can show that, by calculation that this will be 1 0 0 1, this will be 0 1 minus 1 1, minus 1 1 minus 1 0. So only these three and the negative of these can be your stabilizer of your vertices in your interior. That is again by the, you take 1 0 0 1 and 1 1. Since the action is transitive, you can just take one triangle and translate it to the others, right, like this, and this is your corresponding to your interior. This is mapped to another triangle, and you can show the stabilizers are by A, considering A, B and solving that. You get these three, again, these three are the only stabilizers in SL to Z. But in SL to ZM, for M greater than or equal to 3, again, only two remain, in SL to Z, in SL to Z mod NZ. And which one are these? Again, as you have guessed, it's identity and minus identity. That means your SL to ZM fixes all the stabilizers, the stabilizers of your vertices belonging to your interior and edges are trivial. That means the action is free, on the Ferret graph, Ferret. That implies SL to ZM is a free. I'll send a PDF of all these proofs in the group, in the Discord server. But yeah, that's just a sketch of all these things. So you can get now, if you go on to study more, you can actually drop the freeness condition and you can give your exact presentation for some groups. Even if the action is not exactly free. So yeah, thank you. I hope you learned something. I know the last half an hour was a mess, but I'll send you the PDF for it, and the proof is very readable. So yeah, thank you everyone.